Come on, you said you wouldn't stop. Hallelujah. How long, Spirit of praise, for?
Forever.
I pray.
I'll praise you forever.
Come on, let's do it in this place.
I'll praise you forever.
I'll praise you forever.
I'll praise you forever.
Forever and ever. Somebody ought to bow down before him right now. Oh, Lord, I bow.
Lord, I bow down before you. It's total adoration unto you. And with the angels I declare that you are holy, Lord of all.
Forever. help me say,
you're holy forever.
You're holy forever, God.
You're holy forever.
You're holy forever.
You're holy forever.
God, I lift you. I give you praise. Said you're righteous.
You're righteous forever.
You're always right. Ain't never gonna be wrong.
You're righteous forever.
God said that you're righteous.
You're righteous forever.
Forever and ever. God, you are.
Forever.
Said you're awesome.
You're awesome forever.
Our God is an awesome
you're
God. You said you wouldn't stop. Hallelujah. How long, Spirit of praise, Father?
Forever.
I praise.
I'll praise you forever.
Come on, let's do it in this place.
I'll praise you forever.
I'll praise you forever.
I'll praise you forever.
Forever and ever.
Forever.
Somebody ought to bow down before him right now. Oh, Lord, I bow.
Lord, I bow down before you. In total adoration unto you. And with the angels
alone are worthy of honor.
Thank you.
God of praise in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, somebody ought to bow down before him right now. Oh, Lord, I bow.
Forever.
I'll praise you forever. Come on, let's do it in this place. your God a praise in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, somebody ought to bow down before him right now. Oh, Lord, I bow.
serve you today.
How can I say thanks for all that you've done? For giving me your only son. You died on Calvary just for me.
Family, at this time, before we begin our celebration of life, our staff will come and they'll greet you, and it'll be at this time we'd like to have our final viewing for those that have not viewed, and primarily for our immediate family, and then we will move into our celebration of life service. At this time, family would like to come. Certain I'm not going to use it because it doesn't project well. Testing. Thank you. Bow with me for a word of prayer. Father, we, in the midst of our heaviness and our pain, oh God, Father, we ask and pray this morning, God, that you, Father, blow peace and comfort just for right now, God. But Father, before we move another moment forward, Lord, even in the midst of our pain, oh God, it's imperative, God, that we say thank you for every memory that we had, God. Thank you, God, for life and liberty, God. But God, we beseech you today, God, because of the pain that rests deep in our hearts on this morning. Father, your people, we need you this morning, God. And Father, we really did not come to mourn. We came to celebrate, even in the brevity of the life that you created on this side, God. And Father, for every aching and every broken heart, every tear drop today, God, Father, I ask and pray that you let fathers and mothers, relatives, God, feel your presence right now as we deal with our heart problem on today. We thank you in advance for how, God, you're going to facilitate healing. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. My name is Pastor Jerry Bishop, and I'm the senior pastor of the LifeQuest Urban Outreach Center. And on this morning, I am grateful to be serving you even in this painful capacity. In just a moment, I'm going to render a scripture. Then Mr. Tyrese will render a musical selection. Directly following that musical selection, for those that would like to have remarks, we'd like you to go to the center aisle and have a commentary. And if you've been selected by the family, that would be the appropriate time. Then when the remarks are finished, if our minister is still, of music is still with us, if he'll render one more selection, I will then bring us a eulogy. And then we'll do the committal of the body here, so you can have a private moment at the cemetery. In the 16th Psalm, beginning at verse number 5, David, he's at a broken state, and he says, you, Lord, are all I have. And you give me all I need. My future is in your hands. How wonderful are your gifts to me, how good they are. I praise you, Lord, because you guide me. And in the night, my conscience warns me. I am always aware of the Lord's presence. He is near, and nothing can shake me. I'm so thankful and glad, and I feel completely secure. Because you protect me, I have served you faithfully, and you will not abandon me to the world of the dead. You will show me the path that leads to life. Your presence fills me with joy and brings me pleasure forever. I'd like to read verse number 11 again, because if you're looking for direction on how you and I should proceed, it's found in this 11th verse. You shall show me the path that leads to life. Your presence fills me with joy and brings me pleasure forever. At this time, for those that would like to make commentary, share, now would be the time for you to come up and go to the center of the room. And we'd like for you to, if you keep your remarks to 2 minutes, now would be the time to do that, please. Go ahead, Rick. Just Are there others? At this time, we're going to have a musical selection.
If I can't hear from you, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. And just let your spirit guide. And let your word abide. Speak to my heart.
Thank you. Let's pray. Father, as we come to the time of proclamation, Father, we say thank you how you've arranged the pieces, God. The pieces of worship and praise. Now, God, we ask and pray that you open up hearts and minds, Father, and ears to hear, oh God. Father, we ask and pray that you help lift the darkness out of today. Tomorrow, God, the first holiday, Lord. Father, humbly I ask that you use your manservant in a manner that is pleasing unto thee. In Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. When I was invited to come to share, I wished that I did not have the words. But unfortunately, this becomes such a norm for me that I'm unequally prepared. I didn't know the math on how many murders that I had done. But I had a 2-hour window on yesterday. And I journal. I like to write. I like to write my pain to God. And although this is not my son by DNA, I take manhood and fatherhood serious. And I think that every young man is my son. And as I was going through I went way back in a journal and found that from 1991, October 1991, until today, that this is my 85th death by this reason. And from 91 to now, we really could change the cause of death from murder to heart problems. Not that he had a bad heart, but mankind has a bad heart. We've learned how to live, but while learning how to live, we have forgot how to really love. And professionally, it's amazing that we see the pain and we have no care of life, and then we take what we didn't even create, that we never held, never breastfed, never changed. We take somebody's life. But here, murder is more than an act of the flesh. It's an attitude of the heart. David had penned what the answer is to these conditions, and it's found in the 51st Psalm, verse number 10. It says, Lord, create in me a clean heart, renew in me a right spirit. That there's a brokenness that we're experiencing right now. And I felt your pain because I'm a father. I felt your pain because I'm an older brother. But I really felt your pain because that there are other young men that need to have value on life. So someone said that there's 3 degrees of murderous guilt, all of which could be manifested without a blow. It's secret anger, spite, but not having been taught how to love. Right now, one of the greatest things that you and I need to grab with the life is fragile. Can we agree? Life is fragile. Life is fragile. It's more fragile than an egg or a Cartier diamond. And it needs to be carried around like a newborn. Because if we don't treat it with value, it's permanently damaged. And the only way to overcome evil is to shower evil with good. I can't tell you that I know your pain, but I can tell you that I know the pain reliever. His name is Jesus. Create in me, God, a clean heart. Renewing me a right spirit. Because when we're done here today, I can't go home, and you can't go home and not mourn, because when I go home, I have to go meet with another family about a similar issue in another community, all because somebody didn't value. We learn how to love when we ask God to, Father, if you have to, redo my heart so we know how to live. See, unkind hearts, evil hearts, angry hearts are the kind of heart problems that brought us here. But unfortunately, the reason why somebody doesn't value life is because they've never been taught how to value life. You know, we've seen each other in passing for a lot of years. And it's amazing that fathers now only seem to be gathering to bury sons.
That's right, sir.
That our young men are gathering. We're gathering in mass. No more Sam Bean at Cherry Park. We're gathering more to celebrate life than enjoying life. And if I would have to leave you with one thing today, it's you have to understand that there's a season to everything. And you and I never know when these seasons are going to end. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, we're reminded, to everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under the heaven. That means you and I have to live so full every day, because we don't know if that person that we say we love or are with, if they're even going to be here on tomorrow. Siblings, love your siblings as if there is no Thursday coming. Parents, as I know, I was a knucklehead child. I'm thanking God that my family's loved me in the midst of me not being a perfect child. But I had to learn through this pain of death that one day should not go by with you really showing and demonstrating the love factor of those that are your family and real friends. Because how many know you might get the call? That, you know that call I'm talking. I'm not talking about a telemarketer. You might get that call. That the one that you allege that you love, that didn't, you mad at for 3 weeks, a month, 5 months, didn't say I love you, is gone. Life is so quick and unpredictable, it changes. And it's like a season. Can we agree in Michigan the seasons change? A week ago, we had a 70-degree day. And today we wake up, it's 27 degrees. It changes that fast. But one thing that should never change is how you and I learn to gather and love in spite of what's going on. Life is also dangerous. That's why we have to value who we are, what we are. Every day, not just on holidays. There's some people in the room right now that the last three times we've seen each other here doing this. Instead of getting together with a text to meet, we're gathering for death and not life. But watch this. The same writer of the 51st Psalm that said, Lord, he's broken down, he's weighed down, his son has just died. He's saying, God, created me a clean heart. I need you right now, God. Here's how he handled the separation of the baby that he loved the most. In 1 Samuel, they were whispering in the corner because, unlike Nick, David's son was sick. And they were whispering in the corner. And David asked them a question: is the boy dead? And they said, yes, my Lord. Now watch this. Here's how he handled it. In the midst of his pain, he didn't go get a blunt, a beer, a gun. He did not get mad at God. He hadn't been eating. He hadn't had a shower. He had fasted. He just laid down. The moment they said, yes, the boy is gone, he told them, go get my robe. Go get my slippers. Draw me a bath. I'm going to worship. He said, I'm going to church. That's how He said he wanted to take his pain to an ever-listening God. Can we agree that God is listening to us? Then we need to talk more to him. I'm going to say it again. We need to talk more to the only thing that will change this ache and prevent this nonsense going forward. That's the only pain reliever. He didn't whine. He wiped his tears. He got up and he said, I'm going to church. That's what he did. That's his remedy. He went to the Lord. There are two things that's going to change how you and I live after today. Two things. It's going to be based on prayer. It's going to be based on worship, because these are the two most powerful healing agents that you and I need. Can we agree we need God right now? We need God right now like we've never needed God before. Because instead of getting better as a people, we're getting worse. We don't value life. Now I woke up with a different feeling this morning. The same feeling when I have to come to these circumstances, I wake up with a profound level of anger that some family doesn't have their son coming home, texting him, leaving a mess in the kitchen, sigging on somebody. I'm the guy in my family they sig on. So I catch it coming in and going out. Now they taught my grandchildren how to get at Papa. And for a family to not have that makes me angry. What about you? But the question is, what are you going to do about it? It's not a physical issue. It's a heart problem. Before I could even get into my office, I had to take a drive this morning because I'm consumed with the anger that we keep getting together not to hoop at the park anymore, not to walk the mall, but we get together. We're not even celebrating the birth of our children with cigars and bottles anymore. We get together over death more than anything else. Because we forgot. While we're learning how to live, we forgot how to love. And the only way that you and I learn how to love is we have to ask God, Father, we need you right now. Make us over. How many of you ever been a beneficiary of a second chance? You ever, God ever gave you a second chance? How about a third? I done messed up so much, I guarantee they don't even make encyclopedias no more, but all my chances are in encyclopedias. But you get better by asking God, Father, make me over. And somehow when we leave here today, if you and I change gears, we can reach somebody and make sure this doesn't happen again. When you look at prayer, the need for prayer and lack of worship, understand when you combine both of these, they create every single thing we need. Number one, it creates healing. Some people, if without prayer and worship, you're going to carry this anger, this bitterness, this trauma for the rest of your life, or you're going to ask God to take this weight from your life. Number two, it creates second chances on how you and I live, not today, but how we live when we leave here. Prayer and worship creates motivation to do better. And how many know that when you know better, help me out here, when you know better, you do better. And if you're over 45, a man today over 45, and if you have not taken the time to speak into the lives of these young men at every stop that you see them, start today, because it's our fault. Real men raise everybody's sons in the community. I'm going to say that again. We don't leave them alone to raise themselves. Real men raise all the young men of the community. Because watch this, if we don't, this is what happens. It's found in Judges chapter 2, verse 10, and then we're going home. In Judges chapter 2, verse 10, it summarizes how we get to a point where life doesn't matter. It says, then there will come another generation that does not know what the Lord has done for them, nor do they know the Lord. Here we are now, we're in the second generation where we've not let people know how good God is, and we don't even talk about him anymore as being the source of everything we need. Largely because we're too busy to take time out to tell people about how good God is. I'm thanking God I'm here today in spite, I'm full of rage and anger for you. We've never had dinner, ran into each other at the park over the years, various places. I'm mad that somebody's son, now, would you rather him have died from cancer or car wreck? There's a season in life, but these are preventable if you and I, when we leave here, would ask God, creating us a clean heart, and if he's done something good for you, go tell somebody about how good God has been for you. Let me ask you a question before we go home. Has God been good to you? Let me see it. Let me say it again. Has God been good to you? If God's been good to you, give his name some praise, even right now. That means put your hands together if he's been good to you. See, that praise and that adoration, that makes it where you could get to tomorrow. Because without God's help, you and I can't make it to tomorrow. That's right. This weight becomes too heavy. It becomes too toxic. I want to pray for us. Then we're going to do something that's called the committal. But before we leave, I want to remind you of something found in the 34th Psalm. Oftentimes, God can be so good to us that we live a little ungrateful. Can we agree to that? We're ungrateful. We say God's been good to us, but oftentimes, we don't even say thank you. I know you're hurting right now. But I'm wondering, have you thought about just saying thank you that you had him for them years? Thank you, God, for all these Christmases. But watch this. David, at arguably, Tyrese, one of the worst times of his life in the 34th Psalm, he's about to lose his life. And he says, just a second, before you kill me, would you mind if I praise my God?
That's right.
And the law of the land was that you couldn't execute, hang a mentally ill person. They thought that David was mentally ill because in his darkest, worst hour, he said, hold up, I just want to praise my God.
That's right.
That's when he comes up when he says, I'm going to bless the Lord at all times. You and I just can't thank God when we're living high.
That's right, sir.
And I'm not talking about intoxicated, when we're living up. We can't just thank God when it's sunny and warm.
That's right.
And we got a little bit of money in the bank and an extra stimulus check.
That's right.
That we got to bless God's name at all times. And the healing that you need right now is not to be mad at God, but to say, Lord, thank you that I had the years I had with Nicholas on this. I'm going to bless the Lord at all times. I'm going to see my son on the other side. You know you're going to see him on the other side. Some people, you can't say that yet because your travel arrangements have not been made. How many know that you can't get on a plane without making some travel arrangements? Well, you can't get to glory without making some travel arrangements. No one gets to the Father but through the Son. You can't even get through TSA without getting checked out. But today, before we go home, before we do the committal, if you really want to have a reunion on the other side, it's imperative that you make your travel arrangements right now. And those travel arrangements are simply by confessing Him as your personal Lord and Savior. And I don't know about you, I mess up a lot. You ever mess up? I got a lot of sin in my life. What about you? But thank God for forgiveness. I'm going to say it again. Thank God for forgiveness. Thank God for His grace. And then while we're praying, you could say, Lord, I need You to be my Lord and Savior. But I know, Lord, I need You to forgive me. I ask You to forgive me for my sins. Help me, oh God. I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that You were born, You died, and You rose again on the third day. You didn't need to go see a deacon. Didn't need to tarry. Didn't need an appointment with the pastor. You got an appointment with God right now. And I know you came in one way, but today's a great day to get saved. Watch this, Dad. Who would have thought that the last act on this side of your son was an act of a preacher? Because he got more people in church today than Bishop Sapp could have got. Your son, his final act was getting people into worship so they could hear the good news. You ought to think about that for a moment. Because how many know that we've been a little lax about going to church? We've been a little ungrateful by worshiping our Creator. And as I'm praying, reflect that, understand that life is short, it's fragile. And in this season, let's learn how to love like You and I have learned how to live. Let's pray. Father, we say thank You. And God, I ask and pray right now, Lord, that Father, You do heart surgery on Your people today, God. Father, we're ripe with anger. And Father, we're overflowing with pain. But, oh God, we ask today that You create in us a clean heart. Father, renew in us a right spirit, God. And Father, I ask and pray today, God, if someone, Father, is calling out to You right now in the pardon of their sins, receive them, God. Father, whisper how much You love them. Pull them close to Your bosom. We thank You how You're working it out, God. We haven't seen it yet, God, but we recognize that according to Your word, that all things work together for good for those that love You and are called according to Your purpose. Work, O God, in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. At this time, this is the segment of what we call the committal. Understand that Nicholas has lived, he's loved, but Nicholas has left. This is just a temporary shell. Because you know, that's all this is a temporary shell. And what we do is, because in the genesis of life, God scooped up nothing. That's right, we all come from nothing. Nothing, dirt from the ground. He scooped up dirt and blew life into it, said, let there be man. But then at the end, or what we call the exodus of life, we take this temporary dwelling and we give it back to the divine manufacturer. And that's where we come up with the colloquialism, ashes to ashes and dust to dust. That we deposit this empty shell. We give it back to Him. So now we commit Nicholas's body, not his soul, back into the ground, into the earth, and we commence ashes to ashes and dust to dust. Now understand, for those that are believers, there will be a reuniting in the resurrection. If you didn't make your travel arrangements right now, I would strongly recommend that you sit and speak with God Talk to him. You know, how many know he'll listen to you? You don't need to come to church to speak to God. You can talk to him in your car. You can talk to him at the golf course. You can talk to him in the barbershop. You can just talk to him on the stoop, on your porch. But whatever you do, talk to him. Make your travel arrangements. But while you're making your travel arrangements, ask God to create in us a clean heart. I want to pray for our dismissal and the safety as they go for you to intern the body. And it was an honor to serve you on today. Thank you, Ricky, for calling me. It's an honor. But I want to really put something out here that I mean with all sincerity, that if there's someone that would like some grief counseling going forward, I do grief counseling for free. I am licensed to do this. And whether you want to admit it or not, this is some real live trauma. This is some real live pain. And I pastor the LifeQuest Urban Outreach Center. Most of you can find me. Most of you have seen me around. Please, we're located on the corner of Neyland and Fisk. Come through, make an appointment. I'll sit down with you for free so we can help you and others get through this dark cloud. Let's pray for our dismissal. Oh, God, as we've committed your son back to you, God, we thank you for every day, every ounce of joy, laughter, humor, all the love. Father, thank you for helping us carry on his memory on today. Because of you and you alone, we've been blessed to have him, God. But God, as we depart from this place, but not from thy presence, God, cover this family with your blood as they travel, Father, to the internment. Father, I'm humbled and honored to be a manservant for you and this family on today. In Jesus' name. And all of God's people said amen. God bless you. Thank you for letting me serve you on today.
May y'all stand or remain standing. If I can have the pallbearer come up and stand to my left, please. Our pallbearer, everyone else, please remain standing. Pallbearer.
Which way are we going today?
I'm already knowing.